I got my phone vertical.
Hi, everyone. It's Plastic EP here from Melbourne, Australia. And we've got the fantastic Phil Fang Volk from Paul Revere and the Raiders. There you go. Say hi, Paul. Phil. That's it.
Paul Revere, Phil Fang Volk.
That's it. Let's go.
Recognize
that's it. Show him the back. Right. Here's the intro.
On the back.
Hey, bananas, we think you're groovy. Hey, bananas, we watch a movie. Driving chewing buggies everywhere. Just going crazy without a care. Hey, bananas, we think you're groovy. Hey, bananas, we think you're groovy. Love to watch it cause your favorite show.
Hey, bananas, we think you're groovy.
Hey, bananas.
Hey, bananas, we think you're groovy.
Hey, bananas, we think you're groovy. With the fabulous Phil Fang Volk. You're the greatest.
That's a wild intro. Hey, bananas, I think you're groovy. You know, I do like bananas. I eat a banana probably every day.
That's great. How great is it in Los Angeles? Oh, sorry, in Las Vegas there, Phil.
Las Vegas is very hot right now. It's about 107.
Okay.
Hey, I meant to ask you, what time is it there in Melbourne right now? What time?
It's quarter to three in the afternoon.
Quarter to three on the 22nd, right? This is still the 21st, isn't it?
Yeah, that's right. I'm one day ahead, Phil. If you won the Tats Lotto, the lottery numbers, I can tell you.
Okay. Well, okay. So I'm at 9:45 p.m. on Wednesday. You must be on Thursday now.
Yeah, that's right.
You're Thursday at 3:45 p.m.?
That's it.
Okay.
Now, Phil, tell me about your fabulous guitar there and bass. Just tell me about those.
Okay, so... this is what my Vox bass, I don't know if, can you see it well enough?
Yep.
That's the Vox, but it's not the original Vox that I had on Where the Action Is, you know, with the Fang in the back. The original Vox is hanging on exhibit in Seattle, Washington at the very famous and iconic EMP Museum. It's a rock and roll museum dedicated to Jimi Hendrix. Okay? And that's fantastic. Where my bass, my original Vox, hangs. This Vox bass was given to me by a very dear friend because he manufactures these, and he wanted to give me a new one, kind of a mock-up of the, what do they call it, a copy? Just so I would have a Vox with me, because I gave away my original Vox at the EMP Museum in Seattle. But since we're talking about bass guitars, the real bass that recorded most of the record, because the Vox bass did not have a very good feel to it. In fact, I even took the neck off the Vox bass and put on a Fender neck, and we were sponsored by Vox, and they didn't say anything to me. I guess they didn't mind, as long as Vox was selling. They sold a lot of basses because my bass was on TV every day on Where the Action Is with Dick Clark. Did you get that show down there in Australia?
We didn't get it, but I know all about it. We didn't get it.
Have you ever seen it?
I have seen it. Yes, I have.
We did about 520 episodes over 2.5 years. And that's kind of the thing that kind of propelled the Raiders into a national act because we were seen every day. All the kids around the country would turn it on and see us perform. And then when we went to their town and did concerts, we packed the auditoriums and the civic arenas and the stadiums. And so we were helped quite a bit by that show. Because, you know, television can make people stars because exactly. Everybody can see you. And when we released a new single, everybody heard it the same day all around the country. So it made it really easy to launch new singles. But the bass that recorded most of those hits, and you can see it's kind of has some wear and tear down there. It was my Fender Jazz bass. Can you see that?
There yes, it is, right there. Perfect.
That's the one I still play. Let me see if I can put the headstock up to your screen.
Yeah, it's coming. That's it right there.
There it
that's
is.
Fantastic.
It's
yeah, that's right.
Jazz. And on this bass, I recorded Hungry and Good Thing and Kicks on this bass guitar right here. So you're looking at a real relic in the rock and roll world right there, folks.
Can I ask
Fender
you?
Did jazz you... bass. I fell in love with this bass when I saw it. I don't know if you're familiar with Hollywood, but back then on Hollywood and Vine, there was a famous music store called Wallach's Music, and they sold records, and they also sold musical instruments. So this girl comes in the store and puts this bass on the counter and talks to the clerk, says, I need $200 for this bass. Can I sell it to you? And the clerk said, no, we can't give you that much for it. Now, I was in the Raiders. I was making a little money. And I was there with Drake Levin, the original guitar player of the Raiders. And I said, Drake, can you believe that? I got to get that bass. So I tried it out. She let me look at it, try it out. I said, I tell you what, I'll give you $200 right now for that bass. And she says, well, okay, that's cool. But I got to do a recording session tonight and I need it for tonight. I said, guess what? I'm doing a recording session tonight too, which it might've been Kicks or Hungry or Just Like Me, one of them. Probably Just Like Me, because this was in 1965. So I said, I tell you what, I have another bass in my car. It's a Vox Teardrop. It wasn't the Phantom bass, because Vox gave me all the basses that they manufactured, and I had a brand new Teardrop bass in the car. I told this girl, her name was Pat. I said, Pat, I'm going to let you borrow my Teardrop bass, and I'm going to give you $200, but I want to take this bass to the recording session tonight because I absolutely love the way it feels. And I want to record a hit record with this bass tonight at Columbia Records. So we made the deal. We went outside. I gave her my Teardrop bass, and I didn't see her again for 50 years. She never brought the bass back to me. We were supposed to get together the following day and get the Teardrop bass because I was just loaning it to her. So she showed up at one of my gigs here at the country club that I was doing with Fang and the gang, and she introduced herself to me, and I took pictures with her, and I said, well, where's my Teardrop bass? And she says, oh, I'm so sorry. I sold it. So I didn't hold it against her, but it was nice to meet up with her again and find out whatever happened to my Teardrop, because the deal was she was going to give it back to me that next day after she did her session. She held on to it for a long time and then eventually sold it. So what the heck? That's the way the cookie crumbles. I wasn't going to be a hard nose about it. I wasn't going to get angry because it was kind of nice to see her again. And I brought her on stage at our gig and I introduced her and I said, she's the lady that sold me this bass in 1965 at Wallach's Music, and here was the deal. And so I explained the deal, and everybody got a big kick out of the story. So anyway, that's the story about how I got this bass and how it turned out to be the bass that recorded most of the hits on
Phil,
Paul
did
Revere
you,
and the Raiders albums.
Phil, did you do I'm Not Your Stepping Stone with that bass?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, that's what I want to know.
I did all the hits with this bass.
You know why? Because you guys, I had an interview now with Bobby Hart, and he said, I wrote I'm Not Your Stepping Stone specifically for the Raiders, which I didn't know. And because you guys put on the album, that's why the Monkees put it out as a single.
Right. And here's the deal. We had it out 4 months before the Monkees did it. We had it recorded and on an album in August of 1966, and the Monkees released it in December of 1966. But here's the deal. We thought that was going to be our next single after Kicks. And Terry Melcher loved it. We thought it was gritty. We thought it kicked butt. And we really thought it was edgy, kind of a raunchy song, the way it sounded, the way we recorded it. You've heard our version, right?
I reckon your version is the version that the Monkees got.
No, they got an acetate of our song. They took it off the album because the album was already out. And since we didn't release it as a single, anybody could release it as a single, because back in those days, you released a single for the radio stations to play. They didn't just grab an album and take songs off the album. They actually had to get a single, a 45, from the record companies and promote those 45s. And, you know, there was an A side and a B side. And for some reason, Terry Melcher got cold feet. Our producer, Terry Melcher, who's Doris Day's son, he got cold feet. And because Barry Mann and Cynthia Wheel, who wrote Kicks for us, sent us another song called Hungry. Hungry for those good things, baby. Hungry through and through.
I love you.
Now, here's what's funny. That turned out to be the single, and it was a huge hit. I think it went higher than Kicks went to like number three, and I think Hungry went to number two. But it was a good decision, and we put Stepping Stone on our CD. And we know that Stepping Stone was iconic and historical for a lot of different reasons. But a lot of British groups, I even think the Sex Pistols, loved our version. And someone did a version of it. One of those punk groups did
Sex a version Pistols. Of
Stepping Stone based on our version.
Yeah, okay. Sex Pistols did it.
Who was it?
The Sex Pistols did I'm Not Your Stepping Stone.
Yeah, they loved it. They absolutely loved it. They loved our version. And, you know, there was magazine that came out, one of those music magazines that England was known for. What was it called?
M&E. I think it's called M&E.
It had like a one-word title.
Yeah, I know the one you mean. Yeah, I know the one. It's a color photo on the front.
Maybe the word wave, or
something like that,
or something, or rock on, or so. I don't know. But anyway. The magazine came out with a disc on it, and there was a CD attached to the magazine. If you bought the magazine, you get this disc, and the disc had our version of Stepping Stone on it, you know, and it showed all the influences influenced the Sex Pistols, and our version of Stepping Stone was on this disc. That's what I'm trying to say, okay?
And also, Phil, can I say your version of Louie Louie? Your version of Louie Louie, and I've seen it on Where the Action is one of the best versions in the world. Your version, and that's where you're on the snow and you're slipping and you're playing. But I can tell you now, as a music person, Louie Louie, the number one version of that song is your version, without doubt.
Thank you. That's very kind of you to say that. You know, here's the deal. The Kingsmen, who had the national hit, were actually a band that got formed after the Raiders got popular in the Northwest. And they used to come to our dances in the Northwest, in Portland and Seattle, and they used to watch us. And they kind of got influenced by Paul Revere and the Raiders. And the Raiders were doing Louie Louie at all the dance concerts. And we had to do that song sometimes three, maybe even four times a night, because it was such a popular song. It was just a simple song, you know, da da da, da 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 da, Louie Louie. Oh baby, say we gotta go. So anyway, we had to play that song about three times a night at the dances, and the Kingsmen and other rock and roll bands would come and listen to us and get their ideas, because everybody was trying to pattern their band after something the Raiders did, because the Raiders were the biggest band in the Northwest in the early 60s, because Paul Revere made a huge name for himself, okay? So, you know, the Sonics were big and the Wailers were big. And I'm doing a couple of songs from the lead singer of the Wailers. Remember the Wailers? Tall, cool one. That was, his name is Kent Morrell. He has since passed away. But I'm doing two of his songs that we co-wrote together on my new CD, which we'll talk about in a minute, because right now we're on Louie Louie. And I know giving you a break to talk, but I'll be finished in a minute. So anyway, we released Louie Louie, and the Kingsmen released Louie Louie at about the same time, because we recorded it in the same studio a week apart from each other, same recording studio in Portland, Louie Louie. So anyway, that we release ours starts selling like hotcakes in the Northwest. you know, Oregon, Washington, Idaho, Northern California. And we outsold the Kingsmen 10 to 1 on our recording of Louie Louie up in the Northwest. Okay. Now, how did the Kingsmen get the hit off of it? Well, because the guy who sang the Kingsmen version was wearing braces in his mouth, you know, he was wearing braces and he kind of slurred his words a little bit. And when he was singing, "This fine little girl, she waits for me, got the good child out on the sea," you know, whatever he was saying, people thought it was dirty. People thought he was using nasty lyrics. So it was investigated by the FBI, who runs the, you know, the protective services for radio and airwaves and television. It was deemed a nasty song. And because of that, some radio stations banned it. And because of the ban, all the kids wanted to buy it and find out what all the fuss was about. And they wanted to listen to it and see if they could figure out what the dirty words were. And because of that, it just took off. It took off in sales, and some of the radio stations took a chance on playing it because the story of the FBI investigation became world renowned. And Louie Louie, the Kingsmen got a huge boost because of the FBI investigating the lyrics, you know. So that's the story about that song and why the Raiders didn't get the national hit.
Now, I've got to ask you, when did you first learn about the Monkees TV show? Did you learn it from Bobby Hart? Or how did you know, and what did you guys think of the Monkees?
I was close to all the guys, especially Davy Jones. In fact, I tell a story about Davy Jones in my new CD booklet because I had given him a 45 of a record that I had put out in 1970, and he loved it so much, he kept begging the Monkees to record it, but they never recorded it. So when I saw him in concert here in Vegas, we had talked on the phone. He said, "Phil, I wore the grooves out of the song." The song is called Lola Lee. So when I called him back at his hotel, they were playing at the Hilton Hotel in Vegas. Instead of saying, "Hi, Phil," he starts singing the song. "Gentle wave, take my boat ashore. Tell the wind I need a friend. Tell the sun to tell the sea. Take me back to the one who misses me or loves me. Lola Lee." Okay, so he sang the whole chorus of Lola Lee, and I'm just sat there on the other side of the phone laughing because I said, "Man, I didn't know you liked that song that much." He said, "Phil, I wore the grooves out on that record, and I've been trying to get the Monkees to record it because I think it's one of the greatest songs, Lola Lee." So that song is also on my new CD because my new CD is the 2-CD anthology, which spans 5 decades of my recording history. So Davy Jones got me comp tickets to the concert at the Hilton here in Vegas, and I brought him five more copies of the record Lola Lee. I have it here somewhere. I should show it to you. So that's the story about Davy Jones and the song Lola Lee. And I forgot what we were talking about before we got into Lola Lee. What we were talking about.
It's okay, but I want to ask you, did you hang out with Mickey at all?
I don't want to say anything bad about Mickey.
No, I'm just saying, did you hang out with all the guys?
But, you know, he kind of marches to the beat of a different drummer, and we didn't hit it off that well, although we did hang out a few times and smoke some weed and, you know, party. And you know how it was back in those days, you know, the Mary Jane. She was ever present, and everybody wanted to get high and listen to music and smoke some weed and party and have the girls there and blah, blah, blah. You know how it goes. Sex, drugs, and rock and roll.
Hey, I got to ask you about Batman. You guys played on the Batman show when the Penguin was getting elected.
You've done your homework, Mr. Plastic.
I know this. I know these things. Don't worry.
Oh, yeah. We were the only rock and roll band to perform on the Batman TV series. And we weren't with the good guys. We weren't with Batman or Rock. We were with the Penguin.
What was that like? Tell me all about that, please. No one said that.
Oh, that was great. And it, because, you know who played the Penguin was Burgess Meredith. Burgess Meredith, who played the manager for Rocky in the Rocky movies, Burgess Meredith. And he was great. He was a very nice man. He played the Penguin. He really nailed the role. And we were his campaign band. He had a campaign party, and he had a belly dancer there. We played for her, and we played for the Penguin. And it's great because we occupy that scene for quite a long time, playing music. We're on stage, and Penguin is down on the floor doing his little thing with his cigarette lighter. You know, he had that long cigarette lighter in his hand all the time. You know? All right. Penguin stands for honesty. And everybody claps. Penguin stands for motherhood. And everybody claps. And Penguin stands for unity. And everybody claps. And, you know, he does his speech, and he's, you know, a lot of hollow platitudes. But everybody's clapping and having a great time. And then they cut over to the Batman's campaign headquarters, and it's dead as a doornail. There's no party atmosphere. There's nobody playing music. There's no belly dancers. And Batman says to Robin, what are we doing wrong here, Robin? So that's the Penguin classy. Had a lot more excitement, a lot more fun. And it was a great gig, and the Raiders were the only band that ever played on Batman. Their only rock and roll band. I mean, that's quite an honor when you think about it. That's a feather in our cap.
Yeah, exactly. Now I've got to ask you, Phil, tell us about your fantastic T-shirt, the one you're wearing.
Okay, I don't know. Can you see it all?
Yeah, I can see it. It's Let's great. See.
Okay, well. It's Kingston's Mine. There it is. Kingston Mines. It's the number one legendary blues club in Chicago. Am I okay? Am I still lined up with your screen?
No, you're fine. Fine. You're perfect. You look $1 million.
It's a blues club, and when I saw that, I wish I would have bought 20 of these T-shirts, because I've been wearing this T-shirt on gigs ever since I've had this T-shirt, because I thought it was so cool, and I wear a little jacket over it a little bit, you know, give a little sophistication to it. But that face is always peeking over my bass a little bit, you know. So when I'm playing bass like this, you can see those two eyes and that nose and that mouth peeking over the bass. And it's just a cool thing. Kingston Mines, it's a famous blues club. All the great blues artists played there. B.B. King, you name it, you know. Muddy Waters, all the great blues guys, you know, played the Chicago Mines. And I wish I would have bought more of these T-shirts. I'm pretty sure the club is still open, you know, because it's so iconic.
You might have to check that out. Now, let's talk about your new CD. I want to know all about that. Tell the fans.
Okay, it's a two CD anthology with 39 songs. And it spans a 5 decades of my recording history, starting with 1967 all the way to 2020. And is it okay to show a mock-up of the cover?
Yeah, show everything.
Okay. Well, it's going to be coming out in a few weeks. So look for this. It's called that's Rocker.
That's an exclusive, isn't it, Phil? Phil, that's an exclusive.
That's me down here. That's me down there. Holding yep. a bass guitar in front of this highway sign. There was a city in Montana called Rocker, Montana. Okay. We took off some of the stuff that was on the sign. We just left the word rocker on the sign. Okay. And I got out there. My son helps me do the graphic arts. It said exit 21 or something like that. And it had some other information down here. But so we use this photo because I liked the word rocker on the sign. It was a highway sign, right? This is right on the freeway, okay? This sign is right on the freeway. Cars are zooming by, and I'm up there with my bass guitar right there. See me over there?
Yep, I see ya. Phil, I got to ask you, this is an exclusive on my show, isn't it?
This is the first time I've announced the title. So I hope I did the right thing, you know? Because
Phil, what's this?
It's coming out in about 3 weeks. It's called Rocker, and I want people to buy it. because it's a really good project. I'm very proud of it. And I recorded a lot of new songs that I've just recently written. I had a couple collaborators that helped me write. I wrote all the other songs on my own, you know, and they span, like I said, spans 5 decades of my writing, my recording. And I guess it's an anthology, but I didn't want to call it an anthology. I just wanted to call it
Rocker.
What else? What else is there?
What's this, Phil?
Well, yeah, that picture I've used in that's when I released a version of The Times They Are Changing as a single, you know, back when they were trying to catch Osama bin Laden. You remember who took down the World Trade Center? Now, I know this sounds political, but I don't mean to sound political.
Of course not.
We released my version of Times They Are Changing on the same day that they killed Osama bin Laden. And all the people went down in New York to Ground Zero, where the World Trade Center used to be, back in May of 2011. Check it. This is historically correct. May of 2011, May 1st, is when everybody went down to Ground Zero in New York City to celebrate the capture of this terrorist, Osama bin Laden. And I had given a friend of mine a copy of my version of Times They Are Changing. And there was a DJ down there at Ground Zero, and thousands of people had gathered kind of celebrating, right? And he asked the DJ to play this song by Fang called Times Are Changing. And he played it for the crowd a couple times, and the crowd loved it, because it's a rock and roll version of the Times They Are Changing. It's in 4/4 time. It's more of a rock version, and you'll hear it on my new CD, Times They Are Changing. And let's see. This is a picture. Let's see. There's the picture of the band that helped me record it.
That's great.
Fang and the Gang. That was Fang and the Gang back in 2011. And that's me in the middle. Really great bunch of guys. And here's another shot that's on this page. It says, Fang followers of the world unite.
It's great.
I don't know how good you can see those photos.
No, they came up good.
That picture, I used that photo that you just showed that said Times Are Changing on it, right? Where's your copy?
Yep. Here, do you want to see it again?
There? Yeah.
Here
because
it is.
Because if you look at it, see, it says the times they are a-changing. And that's the photo I used to promote that song, that photo right there. But I've also put it in my, to be the cover of one of my CD booklets. So that's the story about that song. But I did it in 4/4 time, and it's a kick-ass rocker. Can I say that on the air?
Yeah, of course you can.
Huh?
Of course you can. You can say anything you like. But let me tell you, where can they buy all this? What's the CD going to be? Where it's going to be released? On where?
Well, it's going to be on CD Baby and Spotify and iTunes. It's going to be on all the digital download sites, okay? But it's also going to be for sale through my website, through my Facebook page, and people are going to – they could send me a check directly to my Sonic. My record company is called Sonic Wheel Records. How do you like that? Sonic
Beautiful.
Wheel Records. That's a pretty cool name, right? So that's my cool record label, and it's going to be released through my record company for now, for the time being. Who knows? Maybe a bigger record company will pick it up and distribute it and promote it. We'll see what happens. You never know. But I was going to tell you something, Mr. Plastic EP. I was going to tell you something when I was talking about my bass guitar, and I mentioned the song Hungry, and I mentioned Good Thing. Well, guess what? I'm sure you know who Quentin Tarantino is.
I do.
The great movie director. Well, his latest movie is called Once Upon a Time in Hollywood.
Yep.
And guess what? He used four Raiders songs in the movie. Because, you know, this is a historical movie that takes place during the time in the late 60s when Charlie Manson was out there with the Manson family. And he was trying to get our producer, Terry Melcher, to record him and cut a record. But Terry didn't want to mess with him because he knew the guy was a little bit weird, you know, and it kind of spooked Terry because he kept showing up at the house, Terry's house on Cielo Drive, unexpectedly, and Terry didn't like that, okay? And so Terry and Mark Lindsay, the lead singer of the Raiders, they both lived in this house on Cielo Drive, and they moved out, and Sharon Tate moved in. And that's why in the movie, they always referred to it as Terry's house. That was Terry Melcher, our producer, who produced the Birds, he produced the Raiders. Yeah, he was the number one producer in Hollywood at that time in the mid 60s. But he lived in that house, and we'd always go there. And so we could have been at that house when the Manson killers came and killed everybody in that house. Unfortunately, it was Sharon Tate and the other people that were living in that house with her. But she's in the movie dancing to Hungary and dancing to Good Thing. And our music is really prominently used in the movie. And I want to thank Quentin Tarantino for doing that, because it really gave the Raiders a lot of credibility by being heard and seen in this movie. He even showed the album covers of these songs. He showed the album covers on her wall, and she's dancing, and Brad Pitt is in the house next door working on the antenna of Leonardo DiCaprio's house. He plays a strange character, this Leonardo. He plays an actor in Hollywood who's kind of like kind of washed up and kind of seen better days, and he feels like he's a has-been. And so Leonardo is very frustrated with this image he's been getting because he's been in Hollywood acting. That was his character. And so he lives right next door to the Cielo house where Sharon Tate lives, where Terry Melcher used to live. So the story kind of revolves around mainly Leonardo and Brad Pitt. And if you remember, Brad Pitt got the Oscar for Best Supporting Actor on this movie. He was great. It was really good. And there's a lot of humor. There's a lot of humor in this movie. But the fact of the matter is, it was a famous movie. It became a very successful, iconic movie. And four Raiders songs are in the movie. So we're very tickled about that. And I played this bass on those songs because one of the songs is Hungry. And I played that bass solo, you know, on this Fender bass, you know. I don't know if you can hear it. You know, it's not plugged in.
Phil, the Raiders have got an album where you guys are standing next to a fireplace. That's in that house, isn't it?
No, that's Clark Gable's house.
Oh, okay.
That's Clark Gable used to own that house in Brentwood Canyon. Okay. That's the Midnight Ride photo. Midnight Ride. We actually got two album covers out of that photo shoot. Guy Webster, a great photographer, he took a few pictures that I'm going to be using in my CD. I have him listed as one of the photographers on some of the photos that I'm using. And David Payne, he was one of the other good photographers back then. But anyway, Guy Webster took us to this house. He said Clark Gable used to live here in Brentwood Canyon at this house. And it's very quaint and ornate and has some great architecture and exposed being has a great back porch. I think we can get a good shot. Well, the back porch shot was used for the cover of the Just Like Us album. Okay. So and then the inside shot near the fireplace with the candles, right? That's the Midnight Ride album. Okay.
You know, you guys have got a new box set out. You know that? There's a big box set.
Where is it?
I don't have it with me.
Did you get it?
No, I haven't got it because I'm in Australia. I haven't found it yet.
Where? Who's advertising it?
I don't know. I've got to go on the net and check. But listen, Phil, I got to tell you.
What is it?
I'm not sure, but it's a brand new thing that's come out with all your stuff.
Well, we've had several box sets. We had the complete singles, the Paul Revere Raiders. That was a double CD. And we had the Essential Ride, Actually, The Essential Ride is one of the best greatest hits album of the Raiders. It's called Essential Ride. And I think Sundays put it out. But it's a great collection. Even used some of my original songs on that one. In My Community, Why. So I was very thrilled about that.
Phil, have you got anything you want to say to the fans before we wrap it up? Tell them whatever you like.
Have I used up my allotted time?
Yeah, I've used it up.
So how long is your show?
As long as you want it.
Oh, well, I'm in no place. I have no place to go.
That's all right. I'm happy to talk to you. Can you tell me a little bit more? Because I'm fascinated with what you're telling me. And like,
I have too many stories. I have so many stories.
Please, tell me something the fans don't know, Phil. Tell me something the fans don't know about the Raiders.
Oh, about the Raiders or about me?
About you and the Raiders.
I rescue rabbits.
Okay.
See those two rabbits?
That's great.
Can you see them?
Of course I can see them.
They were drowning. They were drowning. And I pulled them out of the water, and I gave them mouth-to-mouth resuscitation and a little bit of CPR massage, and they came back to life.
That's great.
You got to love all of God's creatures, right?
That's great.
What did you want to tell me?
Do you know what I want to say, Phil? Yeah, of the band, you know what I love about you? You're the only guy that when they're playing along the Raiders, you turn the bass upside down on the guitar, it's got Fang, and the audience go crazy. They go crazy.
Oh, listen, I developed, that's my brand, and I'm so glad I developed it. Paul Revere always asked me, Phil, you're going to need a nickname if you're going to be in this band. Because, you know, Paul was called Uncle Paul. Mark was called Man Marcus. Drake was called The Kid. And Michael Smith, Smitty. And Paul said, hey, man, Phil, you're going to need a nickname. And since you've got such big teeth, he says, why don't we call you Bucky? I said, no, not Bucky. How about Bugs? No, not Bugs. Let me work on it. So we were filming action, and I thought, you know, I think Fang is a pretty cool name. It has some edge. It has a little bit edgy. Kind of like that singer Sting. That's his name, yeah. Sting. I'm Fang. Yeah. He's Sting. I'm Fang. Okay. So not that I'm comparing me to him, but just the name thing, you know, and because it's an edgy name to call yourself Sting or call yourself Fang. It has a little edge about it, you know. Anyway, it's a little scary. But anyway, Paul wanted me to have a nickname. So when we were filming on where the action is, I went to the electric truck where the electricians were sitting while we were filming. And I said, can I borrow some of your black tape? And they said, sure. What do you want to do? I said, I want to put a name on the back of my bass. So I used that black tape and I did this. I put Fang on the back of my bass. And then when Mark Lindsay was singing a solo, I jumped behind him with this bass. And you can't believe the fan mail I got. All the girls said, who's Fang? We want to see more of Fang. And so when they realized what the connection was, it was me. And I was going to be my nickname. And Paul Revere thought, wow, that is really cool. And we got so much fan mail that they started giving me more songs to perform as a soloist. I don't think Mark was that happy about it, but hey, it's showbiz, right? And we wanted to get as much credibility as we could. And because Fang, the fans liked it, then flipping over the bass and having me sing solos and getting my personality more recognized in the presentation of the Raiders, you know, because Drake was a little more mysterious. He wasn't as outgoing as I was. I was like the kid next door. Happy-go-lucky, fun guy. You know, if you want to have some fun, go with Fang. So that was the image I was portraying, and it worked really good. And so all the teen magazines did a lot of feature stories just on me, which is I thought was fabulous.
Tiger Beat. Cover.
I actually got more covers. Shh, don't tell Mark.
Hey, Tiger Beat.
I got more covers than Mark did.
You know Tiger Beat, don't you, Ann Moses?
And of course I know Ann. What a wonderful
Say hello to Ann, please, because I do a show with her.
She's a sweetheart. I love Ann, and she gave me so many covers. In fact, one of the covers is in the booklet. Let's see, which one is it?
Take your time.
Here, check this out. This is one of the covers. This picture. Let's see. Can you see that?
Yeah, I see it.
I can't see the phone.
Yeah, I see. Just move it across a bit. Stop. Up a bit. And yeah, right there. Fantastic. I see it.
That picture was on the cover of Tiger Beat.
Fantastic.
I hope he doesn't mind me using it. I didn't ask for permission.
That's you. I think you're all right. You're so funny, Phil. You're so funny. You're my brother-in-law.
I'm taking a lot of chances here. You know,
don't worry.
I'm putting stuff out. Although I did get all my mechanical licenses for the cover tune. There's like 17 cover tunes on the album and 22 originals. But I bought all the licenses to do other people's music. So I'm covered there. Okay. But I did use a lot of photos, and I'm not sure who all the photographers were. I tried to list every photographer that I knew. I just said they must have used some of these pictures or taken them. But I listed all of them in the credits. I hope I haven't missed anybody because, you know, sometimes you forget names of people like that.
Of course.
You know.
Of course.
But I got all the major ones in there, and it's a long list of names. You know, in the photo credits, it's a long list. So,
Phil, used to jump on top of the basses, didn't you? You used to jump on top of the bass amp.
Oh, absolutely! And then we play guitar behind our neck like this.
That's right.
You know, and we'd be standing up on an amplifier about 5 to 6 feet off the ground, and those box amplifiers, if you remember. They had two chrome tubes that wrapped around the speaker cabinet, and the amplifier sat on top of those two chrome tubes, okay? And it wasn't attached. It wasn't screwed or tightened. It was just laying there. And so we'd jump onto the drum stage, and then we'd jump on top of the amp. And I tell you, you know, we took a couple tumbles on those things because we were playing and we're moving, and the amp would sometimes slip off. We'd go crashing down in a heap. And that's how Drake broke his ankle on the TV show, The Good Old Days, when it was a reunion of the Raiders, our like 12 or 13 year reunion. It was 1978. It was a Dick Clark production. And we were the stars of this show. And they showed a lot of other rock and roll acts that performed or showed clips or whatever. But the Raiders actually performed live, and Drake Levin and I were playing, and we got on top of the amps, and his amp slipped, and he went down and he broke his ankle on the show, and you can actually see him crumbling in a heap on the floor. They tried to edit it out, but I could still see it where he took the fall. But hey, you know what they say. That's showbiz.
I love it. Whatever happens, all you say is, hey, that's show business. I love it.
Well, you know what? He was a trooper, and he did it on the dress rehearsal. He did it. He broke his ankle on the dress rehearsal, and like a champion, like a real trooper, we had to go back and record for the main show and actually do the real show. And so he did it with a broken ankle. And when he jumped off the amp, he had to jump off the amp at the end of the song. He jumped off kind of weird, and he rolled again and hurt himself a second time, you know, because he didn't want to land on that broken ankle, you know. So when he landed real bad, and that's why he crumbled into a heap. But he was a trooper. He did the show. He didn't let a broken ankle keep him from getting on top of that bass amp. But that was one of our gimmicks that we did. That was one of our trademark moves. And we, you know, we also did the choreography. And we did one thing that it's kind of funny. We would swing at each other's head with our guitars. And I would duck, and then Drake would duck, and I'd swing at his neck. It was called Big Boy Pete. Remember that song? Yeah. Going, was it jumping on a corner? Down on a honky-tonk street, over in the corner, it was a Cadillac, out stepped Big Boy Pete, and then the music stopped. And that's where we did the head thing, all in time, all in rhythm, and we got that close to each other's head. In fact, the first time I swung my neck at Drake, I would get close enough to knock his three-cornered hat off. And then he would knock my three-cornered hat off on his swing. And that's how close we got to eat. And we swung fast and hard because it was time to the music. Big Boy Pete. Now, the reason I'm telling you this is that you can see this song. You can see this performance of us doing this song with that choreographer on the Johnny Carson show. Remember Johnny Carson and yep. the Tonight Show? Did you get that in Australia?
I don't know if we did, but I don't think we got Johnny Carson either.
Did well? It was a late show. It was a Tonight Show.
Yeah, that's right. Carson.
It was the number one late show. You know, after the 11 o'clock news, then the Johnny Carson show came on. And the thing that's so beautiful about this, the show, we did everything live, everything. You know, where the action was mostly lip syncing, because they didn't have the budget to do live performances. So everybody would come on and lip sync their song. Everybody, all the artists, everybody lip sync. But on the Johnny Carson show, we played all our music live. We did all the singing live. Everything was mic'd. It was a complete live performance on the Johnny Carson show. And so when this guy from the Beatle tribute band called the Fab Four, you've heard of the Fab Four, the Beatle band, does a tribute to the Beatles. He plays the John Lennon role. He toured with Mark Lindsay a couple of years ago and got to learn more about the Raiders because they backed up Mark on his show. And then they would open the show with the Beatle tribute. So
that's wrong.
He learned a lot about the Raiders on this tour with Mark. And he saw the Johnny Carson clip and he said, oh, man, we got to do a documentary on this group. His name is Ron McNeil. He plays.
Yeah, he's the best. He's one of the biggest Raiders fans. I've spoken to him.
He played the Fab Four is the number one Beatle tribute band, I think. And that's where I got this bass. They brought me on stage, and at the end of one of their shows here in Vegas, they brought me on. Then I brought my two daughters on and my niece, who sang background vocals, and we did the song Kicks. And the girls are dancing and singing on the microphone. And I'm doing my, you know, dancing and kicks. We're doing skits. And the Fab Four are playing the kick song for me so I can sing it. And they had planned on this. And they put all kinds of slides and photos of me with the Raiders on the big screen in the back of the stage. And so they're showing all this, you know, multimedia stuff on the screen and all the photos of me and the Raiders. And the girls are singing. And I'm dancing around and singing kicks. The crowd is coming to their feet and standing up and giving me a standing ovation. And finally, the song is over, and I thank the guys. I said, man, that was more fun I've had in a long time. And they said, well, Phil, this is a special moment for us, too. In fact, it's so special to us, we want to give you a gift before you leave the stage. And they gave me this Vox bass. Can you believe that? They gave me a Vox bass as a thank you gift for coming on stage. That's a classy guy. And I knew if he does a documentary on the Raiders, it's going to be classy. He's already interviewed me for several hours, 6 hours the first time and the second time in another studio, like another 3 hours. So he has a lot of footage on me. And then he had Roger Hart, our original, come down from Portland to be interviewed. And then he had Harpo. Yeah, Jim Valley Harpo. You know Harpo, who replaced Drake. Because Harpo was there during the heyday as well. Drake went into the army in early 66. Harpo came into the band, and Harpo was there for all the big hits like Hungry and Good Thing and Him or Me, all that kind of stuff. So he interviewed Harpo for about 4 hours, interviewed Roger Hart, our original manager, for a few hours, and then he brought me back in because he wanted to ask me some more questions because he liked all the stories I tell. He knew that I could tell some good stories.
I love it too. Why do you think I'm here?
You've been such a good listener. I got to commend you for being such a good listener. You're not the kind of guy that keeps interrupting people. You're a real good listener.
Thank you. I love your shades. I love your glasses. Have you ever come to Australia? Have you ever come to Australia, Phil?
I've never been to Aussieland, no.
Okay, when you come to Melbourne, you tell me, we hook up.
Oh, for sure. I'd love to go there. I'd love to play some gigs with my band and do some shows promoting my new rocker CD. You know?
That's it.
You got to give me your address so I can send you a copy.
I'll do that after, no problem.
And maybe you can beat the bushes for me down there. You know, scare some people into playing this thing.
I love it. Listen, Phil, you've been so great, all right? And I'm glad you mentioned Ron, because I speak to Ron so frequently, and the Fab Four are just fantastic. And look, you can see how much love is pouring out from everybody, from Ron, from myself. You know, you don't know how big this is to me as a fan. Even though I'm a huge Monkees fan, I'm a huge Paul Raiders fan too. I want you to know that.
Well, you know what? Davy Jones is one of the nicest, kindest guys I ever knew back in the day. You know, he was a great guy. I didn't get too close to Nesmith or Peter Tork, but I was fairly close to Mickey Dolenz, because we would hang out a lot and have parties, and we would always be there, you know. And back in the day, we had fun together, but as time passed, everybody changes a little bit, you know. But Davy didn't change. Davy stayed kind. He stayed loving. He stayed beautiful. And I was so sad when he passed away, because he was a good guy. He was a real good guy. And you know, the Monkees, I hope I can say this, because that nighttime TV show was originally written for the Raiders.
The Monkees.
If you knew that.
No.
Someone did a, Roger Hart wrote a, what do they call it when you write a pilot, or you write a template or a treatment for a nighttime show with using a rock band? And he pitched it to Dick Clark, and he pitched it to couple of the networks, and they liked it and they wanted to go with it. Something went wrong. Certain people didn't connect. And then the Monkees got that slot. I guess the network decided, instead of starting with a band that's already together, they're just going to audition a lot of actors and create the characters by auditioning all the people they wanted to be the band members. And that's how the Monkees formed, because they weren't a band. They were just actors or musicians that all auditioned. You could see it in Variety. It says rock and roll TV show. We need actors. We need people to audition. If you're a musician or an actor and you love rock and roll and you want to be in a comedy rock and roll show, please audition. So Davy and Mickey and you know, Mike Nesmith and Peter, they all auditioned and they all got the gig. And they had to become a band. They had to learn how to be a band together. At first, they just had studio musicians record all their songs, you know, like Last Train to Clarksville and stuff. And eventually, they learned how to play them, and they went on tour, and they played their own tunes. But at first, the music was all provided for them by, the studio cats, and it became the Monkees catalog. And a lot of great there, you know, a lot of great hits. And they did well for themselves, and they were funny. And I watched the show. I thought it was good. I'm sorry that the Raiders didn't get that show, because we had the daytime show action, and a lot of people, including Dick Clark and Roger Hart, our manager, were talking about us being in a nighttime slot because we were so funny and we had so many goofy characters that we played, that this would have been a perfect fit for the Raiders. Somehow it slipped through the cracks. You know,
but
what
you
they
know
say?
What?
You know what they say?
That's so business. All right, listen, I gotta say, from Plastic EP here in Melbourne, take us out, Phil, but stay there for a minute. Don't say goodbye. We'll say goodbye to everyone else. You know what? It's been fantastic. You say goodbye to everyone out there, because the fans love you. Give the fans
goodbye, all you Raider fans. Goodbye, all you Fang fans. Hang in there. I got a new CD coming out. If you buy the CD, then I can get my teeth cleaned.
See ya, Phil.